Hi everyone, welcome back to my YouTube videos. In this video, I'm going to start with a new topic and tell you about continuous time Markov chain. So that's chapter 10 of my stochastic modeling book published by Springer. So the concept of Markov chain was introduced by Russian mathematician Markov. In this slide, I'm also showing you a picture of Andrei Kolmogorov because of its very important contribution also to the field. So in this video, I'm going to define the notion of continuous time Markov chain. We are going to talk about rate of jump, about intensity matrix, and about conservative system. Also, more importantly, after I'm going to show you how we can construct a continuous time Markov chain, and at least a conservative system, from a collection of Poisson processes and also some discrete-time Markov chain embedded into this continuous time Markov chain. So that's going to be the topic of this video. It's going to be mostly to show you the connection between continuous time Markov chain on one side and what we saw in previous playlist about discrete-time Markov chain and Poisson processes. Then in other videos, I cover more of the theory. In particular, I'm going to tell you about stationary distribution. We are going to talk about Chapman-Kolmogorov equations and also forward and backward Kolmogorov equations. And we'll see how those equations can be used to show that the stationary distribution, in fact, is a solution to a linear system. I'm also going to tell you, following the same pattern as for discrete-time Markov chain, the convergence theory of this class of process. In particular, I'm going to tell you about communication classes, the notion of irreducibility, also recurrence, transience, positive recurrence, and null recurrence, and we'll see how those ingredients combined together can be used to prove that we have existence uniqueness in some cases of the stationary distribution, and also convergence to the stationary distribution regardless of the initial state or regardless of the initial distribution. And then at the end of this playlist, I'm going to specialize in an important class of continuous time Markov chain that we call birth and death processes. And as usual, I'm not going to only cover the theory, I'm also going to give you a lot of examples of applications of the theory. So a continuous time Markov chain is a process XT, where T is going to be a positive real number representing the time. So we are looking at continuous time Markov chain with finite or countable state space S. And you see that XT is going to be indeed a continuous time Markov chain if we have this equation that gives you some relationship between two conditional probabilities. This is similar to the notion of discrete time Markov chain, and this means more or less that the process is memoryless. You can forget about the past and only remember the present to be able to make prediction about the future. So that's exactly what this equation between those two conditional probabilities tells you. You can think of time S as the present and time T as a time in the future. And so this equation tells you that the probability of something happening at time T, so that's going to be an event of the form XT belongs to a subset B of S, given the past including the present. So the past including the present is represented by this sigma algebra FS, which is the sigma algebra generated by the process from time 0 to time S. That's the natural filtration of the process. So this conditional probability given past including present is equal to the probability of the same event in the future, but only given the present. So that means that indeed, if you got to observe the process from time 0 to time S, to make prediction about the future, you don't need to remember everything you saw. You only need to know where you are at the present time. So that's the definition of continuous time Markov chain. That's of course very similar to the definition of discrete time Markov chain. And the goal of this video is going to be to prove the theorem at the bottom of the slide. And I'm going to tell you a little bit after about this theorem, but that's this theorem that more or less tells you how you can construct a continuous time Markov chain from a collection of independent Poisson processes, and also using some discrete time Markov chain that we call the embedded Markov chain associated to the continuous time Markov chain. But before we look at this theorem and the proof of this theorem, I need to define a few notions first. So I'm going to define the first important concept in the theory of continuous time Markov chain using a parallel with discrete time Markov chain, so that you see the analogy between the two objects. But you will see that because we switch to continuous time, there are a few tricks that needs to be solved along the way. So first, you remember that by memoryless, by the fact that a discrete time Markov chain is memoryless, we can use those Chapman-Kolmogorov equations to express the probability of the Markov chain, the discrete time Markov chain going from one state to another state in, let's say, n time steps by cutting these those probabilities in between. And so we saw eventually that an elementary piece of the that defines the dynamics of a discrete time Markov chain were those one time step transition probabilities that we just call transition probabilities. If you know the probability of going from state X to state Y in one time step, then you can reconstruct from that all the n time step transition probabilities that we call multi-step transition probabilities. Now, the problem for continuous time Markov chain is that on the royal line, there is no successor, there is no next time. And so we don't have those elementary pieces anymore, which means that even if the Chapman-Kolmogorov equations are still true and they just follow from the memoryless property of continuous time Markov chain, we cannot have those elementary pieces. So this means that a priori, a continuous time Markov chain is characterized by the full collection of what I'm going to call again transition probabilities, but now it's the probability of going from state X to state Y in T units of time. And we need to know that a priori for all time T positive. So I'm going to start writing that. So a priori XT is characterized, the Markov chain XT is characterized by the full collection of what we call the transition probabilities again. And so those transition probabilities, in this case, they are going to be defined as PTXY. And that's going to be, again, the conditional probability of going from X to Y in T units of time. So because we also assume that the process is time homogeneous, that's going to be the probability that XT equals Y, given that X0 equals X. Now, if you know this for all X, Y, and T, then of course you have a full characterization of your process. So we want that for all X, Y in the state space, and also all time T positive. So now, let's go back to, again, those elementary pieces in the case of discrete time Markov chain. Here, we have a priori something analog. You see that if we know, in fact, not the full collection of the transition probabilities, but if we know those PTXY for all T in some small interval starting at zero, so something of the form zero epsilon, where epsilon is a small positive royal number, then from that, and using also memoryless, which implies like equations like Chapman-Kolmogorov's equation, then we can reconstruct this full collection of transition probabilities. So that means that, in fact, it seems that we don't really need to know this full collection. It would be enough to know PTXY for all XY, but only for all T in some small interval of the form 0 epsilon. It turns out, in fact, that we have something better than that. It's the fact that if we know the limit when epsilon goes to 0, of P epsilon XY, but divided by epsilon. That's what we call the transition rate. So the rate of jump from state X to state Y. I use the word rate because indeed there is this analogy with Poisson processes with rate mu. Then if we know this, then it seems we can reconstruct everything. And in fact, it turns out that those ones satisfy some differential equation involving those transition rates. So I'm going to write that. In fact, Pt xy satisfies so those transition probabilities, they satisfy some, so let's say an ODE, ordinary differential equation, involving what we call the transition rate, the transition rates, and so those transition rates, so that's a keyword that we are going to use a lot. We have also transition probabilities here. So transition rates are again defined as the limit when epsilon goes to zero of P epsilon XY, so that's going to be the probability of going from state X to state Y in some very short amount of time. We expect this to go to zero because we don't want the process to jump instantaneously, but we are going to divide that by epsilon, take the limit, and we want basically this limit to be strictly positive but finite. So involving the transition rate, that I'm going to write C X Y, and by definition that's going to be the limit when epsilon goes down to zero of P epsilon xy divided by epsilon. So you see that this is exactly by definition here the probability of going from state x to state y, but in a very short amount of time, epsilon. So if we start, or if at some time we are in state x, what is the probability that epsilon unit of time after, very short, we are in state y? What we want again is in the limit when epsilon goes to zero, we don't want to see instantaneous jump. So the denominator here should go to zero, but we divide by epsilon, and we want this quantity to be positive, or it can be equal to zero, but in which case there is this notion of absorbing state and so on. But what we want is this quantity to be finite. I'm going to write this, so we want, so that the process is well defined, we want this quantity to be finite, so I'm going to write that in red here. That's going to be one of our assumptions. Be careful, the fact that the limit here for all x and y is finite, I'm going to add this also, we want this to be finite for all x different from y. The fact that it's finite is not a property of continuous Markov chain. That's just an assumption that we are going to make. That's a first assumption we need to have what we call a conservative system. But you will see that in practice, this assumption makes complete sense. If this limit was infinite, that would mean that the process would jump from X to Y instantaneously. And we don't want that. And anyway, that's not very interesting to look at those type of processes in practice. So that's the first assumption we want, to have a conservative system. So now, in fact, to have a conservative system, we want something more than that. We don't just want the fact that we cannot jump instantaneously from state X to state Y. We don't want to jump instantaneously from X to any other state. So now, motivated by that, so you see that the motivation here is that a priori XT is characterized by this full collection here. It turns out that to understand this full collection, at least in theory, we only need to know those transition rates, and those PTXY are going to satisfy some system of ordinary differential equation involving those transition rates. In fact, that's related to those equations called backward and forward Kolmogorov's equation. I'm going to talk about that in another video. And So that's kind of the motivation to introduce this. But to go a little bit further and to develop more of the theory, what we need is something a little bit stronger than that to be able to define this notion of conservative system. So let's erase all that. So now, what do we mean by conservative system? So definition, the process XT, the continuous time Markov chain XT, so is conservative. So if, now instead of looking at this limit here, I'm going to instead look at the limit when epsilon goes to zero of one minus p epsilon xx divided by epsilon. And so what we want to have a conservative system is this limit to be finite. So why is it something stronger than this condition? Well, let's look at the intervention of this number. So p epsilon xx is exactly the probability of staying in state x in this very, very short time interval. So you have a very short time interval of length epsilon units of time, and you look at the probability that the process is going to jump at some point during this very, very short time interval. The process is going to step out, sorry. And so clearly you want this probability p epsilon xx to, you know that p zero xx is equal to one. That's the probability of being in state x, given that you're in state x, and you want some kind of continuity, meaning that when epsilon goes to zero, we want this quantity to go to one. Now, if you look at one minus this quantity, you can think of the probability of the complement of this event. That would be the probability of going from state x to any of the other states in this little increment of time epsilon. And so you can rewrite this probability here as the sum of the probabilities of going from x to another state. So I can do this here. It turns out that this is exactly the same as the limit when epsilon goes to zero of, so again, 1 minus the probability of staying put is equal to the probability of jumping from state x. We should not forget this 1 over epsilon here. So that's going to be exactly the sum over all y in the state space different from x of the probability of going from x to y during this middle time interval. So it's p epsilon xy. So that's exactly, again, the probability of the rate at which you jump from state x to any of the other states. So, you see that this condition, less than infinity here, tells us that you cannot jump instantaneously from x to y. If this is indeed finite, and if the state space is finite, then you end up here with exactly, well, a finite sum of numbers like that. So that's going to be a finite sum of finite numbers, so that should be finite. So, if you have this condition, the rate at which you jump from x to y is finite for all xy, then, and if in addition the state space is finite, then your system is conservative. But in case the state space is infinite, then that's not clear. You may have a system where you can jump from, let's say, x to any other state y, let's say at rate one. But if you have infinitely many states, then the sum becomes infinite. In which case, even if you don't jump instantaneously from state X to state Y, you still jump instantaneously from state X to another state. And again, we don't want to have those crazy stochastic processes that just keep jumping all the time, like instantaneously all the time. And in fact, those processes are not relevant in practice. So that's not a big restriction to assume that this is fine. So that motivates, I mean, that defines the notion of conservative system. This is equal to that, and conservative system means that this limit, again, is finite. Okay, so you want this to be finite for all x, again, meaning that when you are in a state x, you cannot instantaneously jump to another state. You have to stay in state x a little bit. And so this defines a class of stochastic process that we call jump processes that will stay put a little bit in each state before they jump again. So that's the class of processes we are going to study, and again, that's basically all continuous time Markov chain that are relevant in practice. So having those assumptions, now I can define this notion of infinitesimal matrix that we use in the theorem. And so the process is eventually, so if you have a conservative system, eventually this process is going to be characterized by its transition rights. So the collection of all those CXY that are the right at which you go from state X to state Y, which is also again the probability of going from X to Y in a very, very short amount of time divided by this duration of time. Eventually you can, exactly like for discrete time Markov chain where we had a transition matrix, define some object that is analog, some kind of analog to the transition matrix, but not in continuous time, and we call that the infinitesimal matrix. So second definition, what do we mean by intensity matrix? So people call that also infinitesimal matrix sometimes. So intensity matrix, it's going to be exactly like for the transition matrix for discrete time Markov chain. It's going to be the matrix of the transition rights, except that for discrete time Markov chain, the probability of staying in state x, pxx, could be positive, that was fine. But here you see that the cxx, the rate at which you go from x to x, does not make any sense. It's not well defined. If you look again at the definition, that means that you look at the probability of staying in state x in a very, very short amount of time, that should converge to one, and if you divide by epsilon, then that goes to infinity. So the intensity matrix, in the same fashion as the transition matrix for discrete time Markov chain, is going to be the matrix of the transition rights if you are off diagonal, but along the diagonal, we are going to define the coefficient of the matrix differently. So typically we call this matrix Q, so that's going to be a matrix Q that's a matrix of coefficient that we call QXY for all X and Y in the state space. If the state space is finite, then you have a nice square matrix. If the state space is infinite but it's still countable, you can still define this matrix, it's just going to be an infinite matrix. And in this case, so you are going to define QXY to be equal to the right at which we go from X to Y if X is different from Y. The definition for what happens on the diagonal is slightly different. Instead, I'm going to do so that the sum of all the coefficients on each line add up to zero, not one. Those coefficients, they add up to one in the case of the transition matrix for discrete time Markov chain. Here, we are going to do so that those coefficients add up to zero. That's just by definition. It turns out that this is a good definition in the sense that this gives you some simplification in the algebra if you take this definition. And also, it turns out that the coefficients on the diagonal are going to have some interesting interpretation. So here in this case, so that eventually the sum of all the coefficients on the same row add up to zero, we need, if x equals y, we need a minus sum over all, let's say, z different from x of cxz. And that's if x equals y. So you see again, that this quantity is in fact, so the intensity matrix is indeed well defined in the sense that all those coefficients are indeed finite. The reason why this is finite, well, you see that's exactly the same quantity as here. I just wrote z instead of y, but clearly my p epsilon xy divided by epsilon in the limit goes to cxy. So we have a sum of the same type. If you have a conservative system, meaning that this sum here is finite, then that means that the sum again here is finite. So now the interpretation of the coefficient in the intensity matrix is that off diagonal, that's the rate at which you jump from one state to another one, from the row coordinate to the column coordinate, and coefficients on the diagonal corresponds to a minus the rate at which you jump from that state. The rate at which you jump from state x, so that's the rate at which you jump from x to z for all possible z different from x, so that's indeed minus the rate at which you jump from x to any possible other state, and again we assume that this is finite, so that defines the intensity matrix. And now I define enough notions so that we can go to the theorem. So the theorem says that if you have a continuous time Markov chain xt that is also conservative, you call Q the intensity matrix of this continuous time Markov chain, and you fix a little time t. You want to know what's going to happen after that time. So we want to answer in fact two questions, and you can think of the two equations on the slide as answering the question when and where. So when, meaning how long do we have to wait until the process is going to jump from its current location that we call x here, and where, in the sense that the second equation tells you the probability at which at the time of the next jump we are going to jump to a specific state y. So more precisely, if you call t the first time, the time of the first jump of the process after this fixed time t, then the probability that capital T minus little t is larger than u, meaning the probability that the amount of time you need to wait until the next jump is larger than u, is going to be, and also given that at the current time we are in state x, so it's going to be exponential qxxu. Remember, qxx is the coefficient of the intensity matrix on the diagonal. This coefficient is negative. So indeed, this exponential here is a number between 0 and 1, and not something larger than 1. So this one tells you that the amount of time you need to wait until the next jump is going to be exponentially distributed with parameter minus qxx. The second equation tells you that if you are in state x, then after you wait this exponential amount of time and you jump, then the probability that you jump to state y, is going to be the rate at which you jump from x to y, which is qxy, divided by minus qxx, which is the rate at which you jump from state x. So before we prove this result, I wanted to comment on one thing. It turns out that those two equations are completely related to the property of Poisson processes that we call superposition property. If you think of a continuous time Markov chain as follows. So you are in state x and you know that the rate at which you jump from x to y is going to be qxy, then it's like looking at when and where the process is going to jump in the future is exactly like looking at a collection of competing exponential random variables, so with parameter qxy for all possible values of y different from x. So you have all those competing exponential random variables that will want the process to jump to the corresponding state. So you have all those exponential clocks that start all at the same time t, And the next time at which you are going to jump is in fact the minimum of all those exponential clocks. And by the superposition property for Poisson processes, that's going to be again exponentially distributed with per meter the sum. That's exactly what the first equation here tells you. This qxy is exactly equal to minus the sum of the parameters of both exponential and variable. The second part of the theorem, like this second equation, tells you also that the probability that the exponential on a variable with parameter qxy is indeed the smallest of all should be equal to its parameter divided by the sum of the parameters. That's exactly this probability. So this tells you that the time you have to wait to the next jump is exponentially distributed. So the time to next jumps are going to be described by collections of Poisson processes with this white minus qxx. And also this theorem also tells you that the sequence of states you are going to visit, without thinking of the time at which you jump, but you only look at the sequence of states you are going to visit, then this will define again a Markov chain, but this time a discrete-time Markov chain that we call the embedded Markov chain associated to the continuous-time Markov chain. And the probability for this discrete-time Markov chain of going from state X to state Y is going to be this probability minus QXY divided by QXX. Be careful, this number is indeed a positive number between 0 and 1. So that indeed shows you, like this theorem indeed shows you a connection between continuous time Markov chain on one side and discrete time Markov chain and Poisson processes on the other side. And you see that those two conditional probabilities can indeed be understood from this notion of from the superposition property for Poisson processes. So now to prove the theorem, it turns out that because we deal with time homogeneous Markov chain, we can just assume that time t is equal to zero, and that's in this context that I'm going to prove the theorem. So now also I want to tell you about the intuition behind the theorem, so why those two things make sense, those two properties make sense. So intuitively, why this must be true that the time to the next jump should be exponentially distributed, even if we need to do some calculation to indeed get the right of this exponential random variable. Why does it make complete sense that indeed the time to the next jump should be exponentially distributed? Well, we have a continuous time Markov chain. The Markov properly tells you that you must deal with memoryless random variables. So the fact that the process is memoryless means in particular that the time to the next jump, which is something in the future, should not depend on the past. So in particular, the time to the next jump should not depend on the times since the last jump. To say that time to the next jump is independent of the time since the last jump, that's exactly the same as saying that the time between jumps must be memoryless random variables. Of course, there are also continuous random variables, so that means that this time, like those times between jumps, must be exponentially distributed. That's a property we saw in a previous video. The only continuous random variable that is memoryless is the exponential distribution. So that explains the first property. The time to the next jump must be memoryless and so must be exponential. Now, what we are going to do is prove that the weight of this exponential random variable is indeed equal to negative qxx. Now, same story for if we look at where instead of when, meaning that the next state you are going to visit should not depend on the previous state you visited, but should only depend on the state where you are right now. And so that means that indeed the probability of going from one state to another should have some should be described. In fact, if you ignore time and you look at the sequence of state visited, you should again have a process that is memoryless, and so that's indeed a discrete time Markov chain. So this explains the fact that you must have your continuous time Markov chain is more or less like a discrete time Markov chain with some that we call the embedded Markov chain. So the probability of going from x to y is minus qxy divided by qxx. And the amount of time you need to wait must be exponential because that must be memoryless. So that's kind of the intuition behind the proof. So now let's prove the result concretely. So to prove the result, the first step. So first, I'm going to put together some preliminary results, a couple of properties that we need to prove to compute the two conditional probabilities in the theorem. So first, I'm going to define the notion of epsilon skeleton of the process. And that's going to be to make some connection between this continuous time Markov chain and another discrete time Markov chain that is not the embedded Markov chain, but another object. So first step of the proof, so fix epsilon positive. Okay, so that's basically a small real number. Eventually, we are going to take the limit when epsilon goes to zero. And so we define the epsilon skeleton. So define the epsilon skeleton of the process. So this is going to be a new process yn. I'm going to write a little epsilon here to say that this process depends on epsilon. And that's basically the process that's going to keep track of the state of the position of your continuous time Markov chain, but at times that are, but only at times that are multiple of epsilon. So that means that this process is by definition x. So x is your continuous time Markov chain, but at time n epsilon. Okay, so we define this process for all n in the natural number integers. So you see that because the process xt is a continuous time Markov chain, you still have this memoryless property for yn epsilon. So that means that yn epsilon is in fact a discrete time Markov chain. So this one is a discrete time Markov chain. That's very easy to prove. That directly follows from the definition of discrete time Markov chain and the fact that xt is a continuous time Markov chain. So now what else can we do with that? Well, I'm going to draw a little picture to show you what the process looks like. So in remember that in the theorem we can assume that t equals zero because we assume time homogeneity. So here we have, let's say, the state space, and this is time, this is continuous time. Then let's say the process starts at state x, goes up to a point here, and then is going to jump to another state y here. So that's maybe a possible realization of the process xt for at the beginning. This process is exactly going to be the process that starts from the same state x and maybe is going to stay here and here and here and so on. So those red dots show you what this epsilon skeleton is doing. So assuming that those lengths here are all equal to epsilon. So that's how you can visualize this process from the process, the continuous time process xt. So now, why do we introduce that? Well, that's because it turns out that all the properties we want to prove about the continuous time Markov chain can be expressed using instead the epsilon skeleton and using more friendly transition probabilities using discrete time Markov chain. So, but what we want to do first is show that indeed there is an analogy between this time t we are interested in. So time t is going to be here. That's the time at which, that's the first time at which the process xt jumps. And we want to look at also the connection between between the state of this process at time t and the state of this process after the first jump. So now you see that in the picture, but that's only in the picture and this needs to be justified, you see that in the picture, the first time at which this process is going to jump is here. Okay, so it's here. So that's pretty close to time t, and I'm going to call this time tau epsilon. I'm keeping the epsilon because, of course, this time is going to depend on epsilon. And the first step is going to argue that indeed this tau epsilon is going to converge almost surely to this time t. So I'm going to define tau epsilon to be not an integer. That's not going to be the first time at which this one jumps. That's going to be something rescaled in time by epsilon. So that's going to be the infimum of t in epsilon n. Let me write this more on the left to have more space. So I'm going to define, so tau epsilon is the first time t, but not any real number. I'm going to look at a multiple of epsilon such that, so what is this time here? Tau epsilon should be here. This time is going to be the first time multiple of epsilon at which this process xt is different from its initial position. So that's going to be xt different from x0. So xt different from x0. Okay, and using the this process instead, that's the same as the infimum of t in epsilon n, such that y epsilon, so at which time, well, that's going to be at time t divided by epsilon, so that eventually you indeed have an integer, so is different from y zero epsilon. So first, we define this time, and I'm not going to write a long proof to argue that tau epsilon indeed converges to t, but the idea is the following. You see that in the picture, if there is nothing crazy happening between time 0 and time t, like meaning the process jumping all over the places, you see that the difference between tau epsilon and t is at most equal to epsilon. So it's at most equal to epsilon, and so of course when epsilon goes to zero, that means that indeed tau epsilon should converge to t. Now, I said this is true if there is nothing like weird happening between time zero and time t, and something weird would mean the process, for instance, xt jumping to another state z in some very short interval of time epsilon. You can imagine that the process xt jumps to another state z and then to a third state and so on, but then comes back to x before this second right point here. So if the process xt does some crazy jump in those time intervals, but each time returns to state x at those times that are multiple of epsilon, then in this case there is a big discrepancy between tau epsilon and t. That means that time t can be much earlier, but this process is not going to see it. Now, the reason why this is not the case when epsilon goes to zero, well, that's based on the fact that not only the probability that there is a jump in this little time interval goes to zero, but we assume that the system is conservative. So that means that the probability that the process is going to jump twice, go to another state z and then returns to x during this little time interval should be a little o of epsilon. So eventually, even if when epsilon goes to zero, the number of subintervals here goes to infinity, it goes to infinity, but it's still proportional to 1 over epsilon, while the probability of more than one jump in those little intervals, exactly like for Poisson processes, it's going to be a little o of epsilon. Eventually, in the limit when epsilon goes to zero, we must have that the probability that that this process xt is going to jump in this interval here without this process seeing it should converge to zero also. So this is kind of the argument, okay, to prove that this time tau epsilon converges almost surely to time t. So second thing we can deduce also from that is for the same reason, because tau epsilon goes to converges almost surely to time t, we also have that the state of the process, of this process at time tau epsilon, so not tau epsilon but tau epsilon divided by epsilon, should be the same, with probability close to one or probability going to one, should be the same as the state at time capital T for the process X. So that means that Y epsilon, and we still need a tau epsilon divided by epsilon here, should converge almost surely to XT. So that's the first result we need to be able to prove the theorem. So now, other things that we need, it's the fact that, and I should probably keep the picture here, it's look at the probability. So because we want to study both the density function of T and also the probability mass function of XT, we are going and using those almost sure convergence, we want to look at probability of the analog for those two quantities here. So now what I'm going to do is look also at the probability that let's say tau epsilon is equal to that should be a multiple, so tau epsilon is a multiple of epsilon, so tau epsilon equals epsilon n, let's say. So we look at the probability that tau epsilon equals epsilon n, and intersection with the event that this here, so that's going to be y tau epsilon divided by epsilon, so that's the same as yn, is going to be equal to y. So we want to look at this probability. Now it turns out that because yn epsilon is a discrete-time Markov chain, this probability is easy to compute. You see that in the case of the epsilon skeleton, then the probability of going from a state to another state in one time step, so one time step for the process Y, is exactly the probability of the same jump, of the same transition probability, but now in epsilon unit of time for the process X. So that means that the probability of staying in X here for this process after 1 minute of time is exactly P epsilon XX. So that means that, so that the first jump is at time epsilon N, what you want is to stay in state X, and so that's going to happen with probability P epsilon XX. And you want to stay in this state N minus one times in a row, okay? So if I put N minus one here, that gives me exactly the probability of staying in state, I mean, from the point of view of this process, and have in mind that the P epsilon XX is like the probability of going from X to X in one time step for this process, that's going to be exactly the probability that tau epsilon is larger than epsilon N. Now, so that tau epsilon is exactly equal to epsilon N, we want the process at the next time step to jump from state X. So that's going to be, that would be a 1 minus P epsilon XX. Now we also want the process to go to state Y. So we multiply, in fact, this probability by the probability of going from X to Y in epsilon unit of time. So that's another property I'm going to use. So eventually you see the way you understand that is if this is indeed this time here is indeed epsilon n, and so that means that this is dot number zero and that one is dot number n in the picture with the red dots, then this picture is indeed some illustration of this intersection of two events here. And so the way you read this probability is the probability of staying here of this red dot here should be P epsilon XX, but by memory less, the probability that we stay again here is another P epsilon XX and so on. And then the probability of going from that red dot to this one, it's exactly the probability of going from x to y in epsilon unit of time. That's this probability here. Okay, so we have those two properties, and that's what I'm going to use to prove the theorem. So now, one last thing I want to show you before we prove the first part of the theorem. It's another thing we need. If you look at the right hand side here, you see that we have those kind of infinitesimal transition probabilities, and we will need to make a connection between those probabilities and also the coefficient of the transition matrix. And so I just remind you also another important property we need to use is the fact that by definition, so qxy, or I don't need to write this, so qxy is by definition this quantity divided by epsilon and I take the limit, so that means that you can rewrite this p epsilon xy as something of the form epsilon times qxy. Okay, so the probability of going from x to y in a very short amount of time, it's supposed to go to zero when epsilon goes to zero, but that goes to zero in a way that is linear in qxy, so that's equal to this product plus a little o of epsilon. And then you have something similar for that term. This term is supposed to be close to one, and it turns out that you can rewrite this p epsilon xx. So again, you look at the complement, that's exactly the probability of staying in state x, so that's 1 minus the probability of jumping from state x. So this one is 1 minus the sum for all, let's say, z different from x of probability of going from x to z in this short amount of time. But you see that again, this sum here with the minus divided by epsilon goes to what we call qxx, like the coefficient on the diagonal of the matrix when epsilon goes to zero. So now that means that this minus this sum is just of the order of plus qxx epsilon plus a little of epsilon. So I'm going to also use that, the fact that this p epsilon xx is in fact equal to 1 plus epsilon qxx plus a little of epsilon. So we have three properties here that we just proved, and that's those properties that we are going to use to prove the two parts of the theorem. So now let's focus on the first part of the theorem. I remind you that we can assume that t equals zero, and so this means that what we want to prove is that the time to the first jump of the process, given that the process starts in state x, is going to be exponentially distributed with parameter minus qxx. So to do this, so of course we are going to use the three properties we just proved. So I rewrote this. Those properties at the top of the board here. So first, because we are this time, so we are interested in the time of the first jump, we are going to look at the probability that tau n equals epsilon n first. So the way you can extract the probability that tau epsilon is equal to epsilon n from this probability of intersection, that just by summing over all the possible values of y. Y should be, of course, by definition, because we jump at that time, should be different from x. So that's the first step of the proof. Let's see that. So we see that the probability that tau epsilon is equal to epsilon n is going to be the sum over all y different from x of this probability here. Indeed, if you add up like all those events for all y different from x, that forms a partition of the sample space. So that means that indeed, if you look at the sum of those probabilities, you extract the probability of this event. Now we know that this is also equal to this, and so that means that eventually this probability is equal to the sum here of the p epsilon xx at the power n minus 1 times p epsilon xy. Okay, so now you see the sum is over y, so this term doesn't really bother us right now. I can put it outside the sum, so that's a p epsilon xx at the power n minus 1. Then, if you look at the sum here, that's exactly the probability again of going from state x to any of the other state y in epsilon unit of time. Looking again at the complement of this event, that's exactly 1 minus the probability of 1 minus the probability of staying in state x. So I can replace this sum here that potentially is infinite. That's an infinite in the sense that we have a sum over infinitely many y, but the sum itself is finite because we have a conservative system. So this is in fact equal to 1 minus the probability of staying in state x. And so we have eventually this simplification. So now, what's next? Well, next we want to look at the probability. So let's keep that in mind. That's the probability that tau epsilon is equal to epsilon n. So then after we want to look at the probability starting, I'm going to write a little x here to say we start from state x. The probability that t is larger than u. And so by this convergence here, we know that this is equal to the limit when epsilon goes to zero of probability of the same event but for time tau epsilon. So that's going to be the probability that tau epsilon is larger than u. So now this means that we can also rewrite this as the limit when epsilon goes to zero of a sum of probabilities of this form. So that's going to be the sum for all so u larger than, sorry, so it's going to be no, the sum for all n, sorry, so it's going to be n larger than u over epsilon, so n larger of than u over epsilon of those probabilities, so probability that tau epsilon is equal to epsilon n. So I divide here by epsilon because indeed there is some kind of rescaling between this the time at which the process yn jumps and the jumps of the process xt. So we end up with this. So eventually overall, I need more space here, I'm going to erase that. Eventually what we obtain is that the probability starting from state x, so probably starting from state x that t is larger than u, is going to be the limit of this sum here, so the limit when epsilon goes to zero of this infinite sum for n larger than u over epsilon of, so those probabilities, but we saw that those probabilities are exactly equal to this term here. So that's going to be a sum of p epsilon xx at the power n minus 1, this times 1 minus p epsilon xx. Okay, so now I can erase this. We have all the pieces we need. And so now the last step is to prove that this quantity here is indeed going to converge to, so we want an exponential u times qxx. So to do this, there's just some basic algebra and also using those properties here, especially this one. Now we are going to say that this is equal to the limit when epsilon goes to zero. So now you see the sum start at u over epsilon, so I'm going to extract that term here. This one does not depend on n. This term, I can extract it from the sum, and I'm going to have a p epsilon xx at the power u over epsilon. And then I can start the sum eventually from n equals 0 to infinity instead. The fact that we have a n minus 1 instead of n, or it doesn't really matter, because anyway, when epsilon goes to 0, this quantity here goes to 1. So instead of extracting n minus 1 of them, I can extract n of them, or it doesn't really change anything in the limit. So eventually this simplifies and we get P epsilon x x at the power, so we said we start at u over epsilon, so u divided by epsilon, and then we still have this sum, but now starting at 0, n equals 0 to infinity, of the P epsilon x x at the power n times 1 minus P epsilon x x. Okay, so now you see that when n is fixed, when epsilon is fixed, this p epsilon xx, so that's a probability, that's going to be something a priori strictly less than 1, maybe close to 1, but strictly less than 1. So this infinite sum here, if you look at this infinite sum here, that's going to converge to 1 divided by 1 minus p epsilon xx. But you have a 1 minus p epsilon xx here. So in fact, that's the big simplification. It turns out that this sum here is in fact just equal to 1. So for all epsilon, not in the limit when epsilon goes to 0, but for all epsilon, by definition, okay, this whole sum is equal to 1. So we have this simplification. And then eventually, to end up the proof, here we are going to use the fact that when epsilon is small, this p epsilon xx is of the order of 1 plus epsilon qxx. So that means that eventually we get here that this is equal to the limit when epsilon goes to 0 of this 1 plus epsilon qxx. Then we still have this middle row of epsilon, and this at the power u over epsilon. Then, so qxx is fixed in the limit when epsilon goes to 0. You see that what's inside the parenthesis here goes to 1, but it's at the power something that goes to infinity. In fact, that's going to converge, and to prove that, you just take the natural log and do some Taylor expansion. You can prove that this thing is going to converge to exponential this term times this term. But the product of those two terms, this one goes away, that's negligible compared to epsilon, so in the limit when epsilon goes to 0, we can ignore that one. But then for the remaining term, you get exactly exponential this term times this term, that simplifies into a u times qxx. So eventually you obtain that this is equal to exponential, so qxx times u. And that's indeed what we wanted to prove. That shows that starting from state x, the probability that t is larger than u is of this form. So that means that t is exactly the exponential random variable with right minus qxx. Have in mind again, minus qxx is positive. So now that we know when the process is going to jump, we are going to prove the second part of the theorem that tells us where the process jumps. So we jump to state y with this probability minus qxy divided by qxx. So to prove this second statement, we are going to proceed a little bit like before. Instead of extracting the time here, we want to extract this event. And for that, instead of adding up all those probabilities for all possible values of y different from x, instead, we are going to add them up for all n larger or equal to 1. So that's how we proceed. So we see first that the probability that y tau epsilon divided by epsilon is equal to y. Again, I'm going to write little x here to tell you we start from state x. That's going to be equal to the sum over all n equals 1 to infinity of those probabilities. Indeed, the infinite collection of events tau epsilon equals epsilon n for n going from 1 to infinity form a partition of the sample space. So that means that indeed you can obtain the probability of this event by adding all those probabilities for all n from 1 to infinity. Then that's those probabilities that are equal to this. So now I'm going to write p epsilon x at the power n minus 1 times p epsilon x y. And so from that we conclude also, so you see that this quantity does not depend on n, this one does depend on n. I can just replace this and go from 0 to infinity instead, but keep an n instead of n minus 1. Eventually, again, for all epsilon fixed, this probability here is strictly less than 1, so maybe close to 1, but strictly less than 1. So that means that the infinite sum here without this term is equal to 1 divided by p epsilon xx. So eventually, so this is equal to p epsilon xy divided by 1 minus p epsilon xx. And then from that, so remember that's this quantity, from that we can deduce that the probability that xt itself, the process xt itself is in state y at time t. So we look now at the probability that xt is equal to y at the time of the first jump, given that the process starts at state x, is going to be equal to the limit of the probability, limit when epsilon goes to zero of the probability of this event, but we know that this is this quantity, so that should be the limit when epsilon goes to zero of this term, so p epsilon xy divided by 1 minus p epsilon xx. And now we are going to again use like those expressions here, those equations. We know that p epsilon xy is of the order of epsilon qxx plus a little lower of epsilon, so that's equal to the limit when epsilon goes to zero of epsilon qxy plus little o of epsilon divided by, so this 1 minus p epsilon xx, if you go back here, that's exactly of the order of so minus epsilon qxx plus little o of epsilon, so minus epsilon qxx plus little o of epsilon. Now you see in the limit when epsilon goes to zero, those terms are negligible. Okay, the numerator is of the order of epsilon qxy. The denominator is of the order minus epsilon qxx, and so you again have one more simplification with the epsilon, and so eventually in the limit you deduce that this quantity here is equal to minus qxy divided by qxx. So indeed, this shows the second part of the theorem. So again, this theorem tells you how you can construct the process. You can think of a continuous time Markov chain as the same thing as a discrete time Markov chain. That's going to be the embedded Markov chain, the one that has transition probabilities pxy equal to minus qxy divided by qxx. Except that now, instead of jumping at each time step, you are going to wait for an exponential amount of time with parameter minus qxx before the next jump. So this theorem shows you how you can construct continuous time Markov chain, but only a certain class of continuous time Markov chain that we call, in fact, non-explosive Markov chain. there are other types of Markov chain that are still conservative system, but that can go to infinity in a finite time. And for those processes, of course, the construction only allows you to construct the process before the process explodes. Because this video is already pretty long, I'm going to stop here and I'm going to tell you about explosive Markov chain in the next video.